Okay, good evening, everybody. I welcome you one last time on behalf of the Faculty of Science and the Albert Einstein Center for Fundamental Physics to this year's Einstein Lectures, and we are about to hear Alan Guth give his third lecture. Now I have said these things too many times, so I won't say much about Alan anymore, except that today he had a little bit time to relax and experience Bern, and for example, Professor Ott showed us the Einstein House, and then Thomas Schuler, who is also in the audience, showed us his office, which happens to be Einstein's office in the House of Cantons, which used to be the patent office. And so that's the building just next door. That's where we went, tracing Einstein's footsteps on his way to work. And so Alan got a chance to see Einstein's office, which is somewhere here. And then we could compare the picture with an original picture that we found in a book. And we could actually convince ourselves that the radiator looks very similar, so we could believe that it was actually the right room. And so we spent a little bit of time looking around in Einstein's old office. Which brings me to show you this office, and you may guess whose office that is. And I told you that Alan Guth has gotten many prizes, including the Dirac Medal, the Fundamental Physics Prize, the Kavli Prize, but I didn't tell you that yet, that he also was awarded the prize for the messiest office in the Boston area by the local newspaper, which is the Boston Globe. So he was nominated by his colleagues with this picture. And he won this competition, I think, without any problem. So he may even have the messiest office in the observable universe, I would claim. Now, in a sense, this has a lot to do with inflation and maybe with today's talk, because the arrow of time has something to do with the second law of thermodynamics, which tells us that entropy or disorder will increase with time, and the inflationary universe actually prepares a universe which is very ordered, very homogeneous, without much disorder. And I guess Alan just wanted to prove that he is the person who can create the largest amount of entropy or disorder in the shortest amount of time. But I'm sure this problem of arrow of time has more interesting aspects, so I'm looking forward to hearing what you have to say about that.
Thank you, Uwe, for that great introduction. Maximally emphasizing one of my greatest talents, which was the winning of that award. Okay, thank you for coming back. And today what I want to talk about is the arrow of time, which is one of these big problems in physics that has been around for hundreds of years or more. And it's not very often, really, that one thinks that one has something interesting new to say about a problem that's 100 or more years old. But I think the work that I'm doing, which is in collaboration with Sean Carroll, by the way, and it's really his fundamental idea, I think, that we're pursuing, really is a new idea about how we should view the arrow of time. And I'll be hoping to present that to you. So the key issue is that when we observe things happening around us, there is certainly a very clear arrow of time, illustrated, for example, by what happens when an egg hits a table. We don't have any ambiguity in our minds when we look at those pictures in what order they happened. It's perfectly clear, and you would never imagine that it could possibly happen from right to left. It only happens from left to right. And what makes that a problem from the point of view of trying to understand the underlying physics is the, oh, I forgot to say again, this is a collaboration with Sean Carroll, and Chen Yao Tseng is a graduate student who's working with Sean Carroll. The basic mystery is that real events show a very clear arrow of time, but at the same time, the fundamental laws of physics, as far as we can tell, are completely time symmetric. So it's not so obvious why nature behaves in a way which has this terribly well-defined arrow of time. Now, before I go on, I just want to say something for people who want to raise some questions here. Since the time of the discovery of CP violation, which from the work of Fitch and Cronin in 1964, we've known that what physicists call T symmetry is not a good symmetry. I don't know if anybody has ever actually seen a violation of T symmetry, to tell you the truth, but CPT is a symmetry that's guaranteed for any Lorentz invariant local quantum field theory. C means charge conjugation, a symmetry which turns every particle into its antiparticle. P means parity, a symmetry which just reflects space through a point, turning everything inside out. And T is time reversal by itself. And this product, CPT, is guaranteed to be a symmetry in the context of quantum field theory, which is how all of particle physics today is carried out. So in 1964, Fitch and Cronin discovered that the product CP actually is violated by kaon decays, a very difficult to see effect in a very rare kind of a decay. And that means that T must also be violated. So one might say that maybe the laws of physics are not really time reversal invariant. But Sean and I, in our paper, would like to claim that in spite of this fact, there really is no distinction in nature between the future and the past. And the point that we're trying to make is that CPT itself is a perfectly well-behaved time reversal operator. That is, as long as CPT is a symmetry, we really can say that there's no distinction in the laws of physics between the future and the past. To spell that out in more detail, I lost my train of thought here. The key point is that for every state, there does exist a corresponding state, which in this case is the CPT conjugate, which will evolve according to exactly the same trajectory, except in the opposite direction in time. And another way of looking at it is to recognize that when T was thought to be an exact symmetry before 1964, it meant that to construct the time reverse of a state, what you had to do was to reverse all of the momenta and reverse all of the spins. And that's what T-symmetry does. It reverses all the momenta and reverses the spins. Now we know that to get the exact time reverse state, you have to do a little bit more than that. You have to also reflect through a mirror and change every particle into its antiparticle. But except for the fact that it's a more complicated operation, the result is still the same, that you achieve at the end a state which will evolve along the same trajectory exactly as a function of time, but going entirely in the opposite direction. So as long as we're willing to accept CPT as the time reversal operator that is exact in nature, we can say that nature really is exactly invariant between the future and the past, which amplifies this problem. Why is it that the world around us doesn't seem to have that symmetry at all, but has a very distinct arrow of time in which the future is very different from the past? Some interesting comments about this problem were made by Richard Feynman in his book, The Character of Physical Law, published in 1965. These were lectures, actually public lectures similar to this, I guess, that Feynman gave. In probably the year before it was published. And he has a chapter, a whole lecture actually, on the distinction between the future and the past. And he said that the most obvious interpretation of this evident distinction between past and future and this irreversibility of all phenomena would be that some laws, some of the motion laws of the atoms, are going one way. There should be, somewhere in the works, some kind of a principle that uxels only make wuxels, very Feynman-esque, never vice versa. And so the world is turning from Uxley character to Wuxley character all the time. And this one-way business of the interactions of things should be the thing that makes the whole phenomena of the world seem to go one way. But, he goes on to say, we have not yet found this. That is, in all the laws of physics that we have found so far, there does not seem to be any distinction between the past and the future. Now, these comments were actually made very much near the same time that CP violation was found. I don't really know if he made the statement before or after CP violation was found, but I would think that he would make the same statement after, as I explained, thinking of CPT as a perfectly good symmetry that turns the future into the past. Okay, so how does one understand what's going on, at least? And we do have, even though we're not sure of the origin of the arrow of time, we do have a pretty good description of what the arrow of time is all about. And that is, it is about entropy. And this is standard stuff. This is nothing new here. Ordered systems tend to evolve into disordered systems. So the world was turning from an ordered state to a disordered state. And that's exactly what Feynman went on to say in his lectures. And we understand that. There are just many more disordered states than ordered states. So if a system randomly moves through the space of all possible states, it tends on average to move to a disordered state from an ordered state, as you saw from my office. And there are other examples in nature as well, I'm told. Okay, so the measure that physicists use, I guess other scientists as well, for this disorder is what's called entropy. And it can be precisely defined. And we always see the entropy increase and never decrease. And that statement is what we call the second law of thermodynamics. And it's usually thought of as being a statistical law, not a fundamental law of nature, but something which happens when you apply simple probability theory to the fundamental laws of nature. So we understand that if you start with a low entropy state, it will naturally evolve into a high entropy state. And the classic example of that is as a gas in a box. You can imagine placing a gas in the corner of an otherwise evacuated box, and it will naturally spread to fill out the box. And that's easy to visualize and easy to understand as what you expect to happen. So in the course of doing that, it's going from a low entropy state to a high entropy state. And once it reaches this high entropy state, once it fills the box, then the gas does reach an equilibrium state, a state in which the gas is uniformly distributed through the box. And from then on, it stays in that equilibrium state with small random fluctuations about the equilibrium, but always basically being in this equilibrium state. You can imagine thinking about the opposite motion, where the gas that fills the box all rushes into the corner. There is a state that does that. In fact, if you start it in the corner and let it fill the box, if you take the exact time reverse of the state that you've got, it will, in fact, run back and all occupy the corner. But states like that are incredibly rare in the space of all states. So while it's possible for the gas to all recollect in the corner, it's highly improbable if you're starting with a typical state. So statistically, we understand how highly ordered states are likely to become disordered and not the other way around. Okay, so that, however, still leaves an important question, which is that if we want to think of this gas in the box as being a metaphor for the world around us, for the universe, then there's the question of how did the universe get into this highly ordered state? Who put the gas in the corner of the box, so to speak? And that's the question which I'll be talking about, basically, and the question which is still kind of a mystery. Now, one possible answer, which actually was considered way back when, proving that this subject is more than 100 years old, Ludwig Boltzmann himself considered the question of whether the low entropy initial state could just be a rare fluctuation from equilibrium. Is it possible that the world that we see is really part of a very large world, which is actually in thermal equilibrium? But in thermal equilibrium, there are fluctuations, and big fluctuations happen rarely, and bigger still fluctuations happen more rarely, but essentially anything can happen. So Boltzmann asked himself, is it possible that all the world around us, everything we see, is just a fluctuation from a state which is actually in thermal equilibrium? And he gave an answer which now we think is wrong, but he said yes. He's in an article that he wrote in Nature in 1895, he made the statement that assuming the universe great enough, the probability that such a small part of it as our world should be in its present state is no longer small. So he says that if the entire system is big enough, somewhere there'll be a whole system as big as what we observe. I don't know how big he was thinking of what he was observing, but everything that astronomy tells us. He concluded it could just be a fluctuation. Nowadays, we view that as being wrong, and Feynman discussed it in that very lecture that I talked about and explained why it was wrong. Here, I think I'm paraphrasing him, I'm not quoting, but this is the argument that I think many modern cosmologists would give you, and Feynman gave us. Feynman says, no, it cannot be a thermal equilibrium fluctuation. And that's because if it was a fluctuation, then it would not extend nearly so far as what we see. The point is that Boltzmann was right that we don't know how big the universe is, and if it's big enough, maybe somewhere there would be a huge space that looks like our observable universe just as a thermal fluctuation. But we do know how to calculate relative probabilities as well. And the point is that there'd be many, many more situations where fluctuations in a smaller region will happen, but we'll still have people in them like us. So to continue reading my slide, Boltzmann was right that we don't know how big the universe is, so no matter how improbable it may be for a galaxy like ours to form as a fluctuation, I guess Feynman was quoting Boltzmann as talking about our galaxy as being our world, it may still be likely that it happens. But, Feynman argued, we still know something about relative probabilities. It will be vastly more likely to form an isolated galaxy surrounded by equilibrium gas than to form two galaxies. And the probability of seeing 10 to the 11 galaxies, which is a current estimate for the number of galaxies in the visible universe, is too small to even think about. So the point is that it's something if the universe is big enough, we'd expect to see somewhere fluctuations as large as our visible universe, but there'd be many more galaxies that will happen in isolation. And therefore, if we existed as a thermal fluctuation, the overwhelming probability is that we would be living in a very small world, and beyond that world, there would just be a thermal equilibrium gas that we would recognize as such. Treating the low entropy state is just a thermal fluctuation does not seem to work. So how do we proceed? The usual answer is that the low entropy initial state must come from cosmology, that somehow it must just be a feature of the way the universe started. And since we don't really know how the universe started, that's something you can always say. And that is basically what Feynman ended up saying in his Character of Physical Law lecture. So the idea of a cosmological solution is that at some early time, the universe was born by, here it says, quantum fluctuations. Why not? And then shortly after, inflation happened, and then the universe expands and starts accelerating again. That's why it starts getting wider again here. This is a picture that was made by the WMAP team, so it has a WMAP satellite as the final evolution of of civilization. So the question is, can we attribute the low entropy state to what happened there, and if so, how? And remember, you know, my point of view is to place a lot of emphasis on the fact that all of the laws of physics that we know are time reversal invariant. The usual thing that's said about this cosmological solution is that whatever it is that determined the initial conditions of the universe violated that time symmetry. The initial conditions were low entropy, but the final conditions are not. And you're just simply proposing that there's something strange about the laws of physics, which in this one context violates time symmetry, but in no other context, as far as we know, does it violate time symmetry. So the question is, do we really need that, or is there some other way of doing it? And one question is whether or not inflation itself can determine the arrow of time. And this is an issue that was, in fact, discussed very early in the history of inflation. In 1983, this gentleman, Paul Davies, wrote an article in Nature. Paul Davies, I just thought I'd mention, is someone who you might know through his popular level books. In 1974, he wrote a book that, in fact, was called The Physics of Time Asymmetry. And he's written a number of other popular level books. Now, I have to admit that I'm pretty sure I'm the person who introduced him to his literary agent. So I feel somewhat responsible for all this, but not completely. I haven't read most of these books, so I don't know if they're good books or not, but that's a little hard to believe anybody could write that many good books. So anyway. Anyway, let's get back to what Paul Davies had to say about inflation and time symmetry. The article he wrote appeared in February 1983, just shortly a few years after inflation was proposed. And he said that the recently proposed inflationary universe scenario explains several of the mysteries of modern cosmology. I argue here that it also provides a natural explanation for the origin of time asymmetry, time's arrow in the universe. And he goes on to explain how if you have an inflating universe, during the inflation, entropy is thinned out by the enormous expansion, resulting in a state that has a low entropy density. I think from my point of view, his argument is valid to the extent that it explains how inflation amplifies an arrow of time. But he doesn't really address the question of can inflation start in a system which does not yet have an arrow of time. So I think what he contributed is real, but doesn't fully answer the question. And that's, at least in part, what was came up in a rebuttal of this paper published shortly later by Don Page. Here's a picture of Don Page with Stephen Hawking. Don is flouting a dollar bill that he won in a bet with Stephen Hawking. I forget what the bet was about, but Don was very glad to have won that bet. He wrote an article about 6 months later, in July 1983, saying inflation does not explain time asymmetry. And the text of his introduction says that Davies has argued that the inflationary cosmological scenario provides a natural explanation for the time asymmetry of the universe. Here, I dispute this argument by noting that the inflationary scenario implicitly invokes time asymmetry with the assumption of the absence of initial spatial correlations. To be honest, I'm not sure if I understand that statement exactly, but I think it is true that Davies' paper did really assume that inflation got started without worrying about how that would happen in a system without an arrow of time. Then Page went on to say that no scenario based on CPT invariant dynamical laws can explain the time asymmetry apart from postulating or explaining these special initial conditions, as Penrose has emphasized. So in my lecture today, I want to argue with that sentence in Page's explanation. He said that no scenario based on CPT invariant dynamical laws can explain the time asymmetry apart from postulating or explaining these special initial conditions. And I'm going to argue that that sentence is false by basically giving a counterexample. Learning that this sentence is false, I think, really does open a new window for how the arrow of time question can be answered, which I'll try to persuade you of. OK, so what is the new idea? The new idea is sometimes called the spontaneous two-headed arrow of time. And it really was first described in a paper by Sean Carroll and Jennifer Chen back in 2004. And recently, there's been some related work. And in particular, there's a paper by Raphael Busso from 2012. Although Raphael's paper, I think, is in some ways more like a detailed version of Paul Davies' original paper. That is, I think it really addresses the question of how does inflation preserve an arrow of time rather than how can inflation from the very beginning create an arrow of time. So I am currently working, although I'll admit I've been currently working on this for a long time and we haven't made much progress actually writing something, but we think we know exactly what we want to write with Sean Carroll, Chen Yao Tseng, and and me. And the key idea is really very simple. It's that if we make the assumption that the maximum possible entropy for the universe is infinite, and that's a plausible assumption, although I think we don't really know for sure enough about the underlying laws of physics that describe the universe to know absolutely whether or not the maximum possible entropy is infinite. But in most of our theories, the maximum possible entropy is infinite. So if we assume that that's true, it's at least one of two possibilities, then the entropy can increase from any starting point. The key idea is that if the maximum possible entropy is infinite, then any entropy is small, because it's small compared to the maximum, which is infinite. So the metaphor of a gas in a box gets replaced by a system which has no maximum possible entropy. And the simplest such system that I know of is just a gas without a box. So basically, we're going to be talking about what happens when you replace the gas in a box with a gas without a box. So let's think about a gas without a box. This really will form a toy model that will illustrate the falsity of Don Page's statement. We're going to use a gas without a box to illustrate the fact that we can create a toy model which shows that it is possible to create an arrow of time from time-symmetric laws of physics and from a time-symmetric initial conditions. So no arrow of time has to be put in by hand, and we claim that an arrow of time will nonetheless arise. So here's the model. It is just a gas. I'll describe it in more detail than just saying it's a gas, but that's all it is. We're going to consider a gas of n, where n is some large number of non-interacting particles moving in empty, infinite space. So they just move on straight lines. Nothing could be simpler. We want to choose the initial conditions somehow. So we imagine making up a probability distribution for both positions and velocities. And for simplicity, we'll assume it's just one probability distribution for position that we can use to choose all of the particle positions, and one probability distribution for velocity that we can use to just choose all the velocities. To make sure that things are time reversal invariant, I didn't write it on the slide, but we'll insist that in the probability distribution for velocities, the probability that the velocity points that way should be equal to the probability that it points the opposite way, so that there's no time asymmetry built into the velocity distribution. And then we imagine, whoops, where'd I go? Then we imagine choosing by a random number generator the initial positions and the initial velocities for these n particles. And that then becomes our system, and now we want to study how that system will behave as we watch it over time. So an important feature of the analysis I'm going to show you is that the probability distributions that we're talking about have to be normalizable. That is, the probabilities have to be able to be defined so that they add up to one. Now, this is something which mathematicians, as far as I know, always insist on, just for the whole system to make sense. And in particular, it rules out some options that some of my physicist friends actually would like to think is plausible. In particular, it rules out a uniform probability distribution. That is, if you insist that the probability distribution be normalizable, you cannot say that there's equal probability for the particle to be anywhere in space. There's no way to make that normalizable, no way to make those probabilities add up to one. So since this is an important issue, let me say a little bit more about it. We really are saying that a uniform probability distribution is really just not logically possible because it's not normalizable. Now, I think most all mathematicians will immediately agree with my statement, and most physicists will too, I think. But there are some physicists who have argued with me about that, so I'll spell out the argument that I make concerning this issue. The point that I want to make is that it's not just a mathematical nicety to require the probability distribution to be normalizable. It really is a logical necessity. And you really do get real contradictions if you try to pretend that it makes sense to talk about a probability distribution which is just uniform throughout space. So let's imagine the contrary. Let's imagine that I could have a random number generator that was equally likely to generate any real number, any number on the real line. I want to show you that that leads to contradictions. And it leads, in fact, to many contradictions. The simplest one I know of is one that I learned from someone named Aaron Wall, and this is the one that I will tell you about. What I want to do to show you how we get a contradiction is to imagine generating two numbers in succession, A and B, from this probability distribution that's equally likely to be anywhere on the real line. And then I want to ask the question, which one is likely to have the larger magnitude? Now notice that A and B are equally likely to happen in either order, because if this really is a random number generator, each run of the random number generator is independent of anything before or after. So the probability of getting AB is the same as the probability of getting BA. The probability of these A and B are equally likely to happen in either order. Now, if A is generated first, then we can ask what is the probability that the magnitude of B will be larger. We're comparing the magnitudes of these two numbers. And since we know the order doesn't matter, they're equally likely to have happened in either order, the larger magnitude is equally likely to have happened in the first one or the second one. So there's a clear, unambiguous argument that says that the probability that the magnitude of B is larger is exactly a half. Now that's fine, except there's another argument which gives a very different conclusion. Suppose we think about what happens after we've generated A, and we're now thinking about now we're going to generate the random number B. We can ask ourselves, on the real line, how much of the real line will produce a number whose magnitude is smaller than the magnitude of A? And that's everything from minus the magnitude of A to plus the magnitude of A, so it's finite length. And you could ask how much of the real line will produce a number whose magnitude is larger, and it's the whole rest of the real line, an infinite range. And therefore, by this argument, the probability should be 1 that the second number has a larger magnitude than the first. And both of these arguments, I claim, are perfectly rigorous. There's not really any good way to talk yourself out of either one of them. And the bottom line, from my point of view, is that this is a clear demonstration that the mathematicians are right. You really should consider only normalizable probability distributions, which means that this notion that there could conceivably be a probability distribution that's just uniform everywhere in space really makes no sense at all and should never be considered. So contradictions like this have convinced mathematicians and me that a uniform probability distribution is simply not conceivable. So we're only going to talk about normalizable probability distributions. Now, normalizability implies something very interesting. It says that no matter how you think of the probability distribution, it is basically localized. It means that no matter how you've laid down these particles in space, I could just choose an arbitrary origin and consider spheres centered on that origin. And if I make those spheres bigger and bigger, eventually those spheres will include 99.99% of the particles, or whatever number I choose. But I'll use 99.99% as a sample number that's almost one, but not quite. And the point is that you have to be able to reach that, because if you know if you make it infinitely big, the probability will be 1, and it has to approach that. So somewhere it has to cross 99.99%, and that's what I want to talk about. I will call that the 99.99% sphere. So it's very important that we understand this. No matter how we lay down these particles, there has to be some sphere that's big enough to incorporate 99.99% of the probability distribution. And if that were not the case, it could not be normalizable. So let's imagine that. Here's my 99.99% sphere, and we can draw the random particles with their random velocities. And initially, these particles can be moving every which way. We have the velocities have been chosen randomly, so some will be inward, some will be outward, pointing every which way. And there'll be no significant trend that you'd be able to see in the initial configuration. And in fact, the way we generated this initial configuration is by construction, statistically the same as what we would get if we reversed all the velocities. So it is a time reversal invariant statistical distribution that we use to create this. So now let's imagine what happens at late times. And by late times, what I want to look at is times that are so large that the mean velocity of these particles times the time I'm going to wait gives a distance which is large compared to the radius of my 99.99% sphere. So now I'm going to wait till a time that's long enough so that almost all the particles are outside the 99.99% sphere. And therefore, I'll redraw the picture so the 99.99% sphere is a small circle in the middle, and all the particles are moving away from it. Now, all the particles are moving away from it because all of the particles were, at time zero, inside the sphere. And they all left that sphere, or at least were all contained in that sphere at the same time, and now we're looking at a much later time. So all of them are moving away, and in fact, we even know approximately what the velocity of each particle has to be from where it is, because we know if we trace back that velocity at time zero, it has to be inside the 99.99% sphere. So roughly speaking, the velocity of each particle is proportional to its distance from the center. So we have now a distinct distribution of velocities, which very clearly, just from looking at it, you can see is not the least bit time reversal invariant anymore. All the particles are moving out. None of them are moving in. We really have created a system which unambiguously has an arrow of time in the sense that the future is very different from the past. We have this uniform motion outward. And we can define, I don't want to get into details here, but we can define entropy, or more precisely what's called coarse-grained entropy, which does grow as it should. So we really have created the growth of entropy of exactly the same type that we see in the real world, that entropy increases, with a very analogous definition of what entropy is. So we've created an arrow of time, starting out with none and using laws of evolution which are completely time reversal invariant. Now this gives a very interesting global picture, because if we took that same starting point that we generated with our random number generator and followed all of those particles to negative values of t, we would see the same thing, because after all, the laws of physics are, in fact, make no distinction between t and minus t. So if we followed that same distribution backwards in time, we would see the entropy get larger in the deep past. And in the deep past, we would see all the particles moving inward toward this center region. But there would again be a very well-defined arrow of time, with the entropy getting larger and larger the further you go back into the past. Okay. Yeah. So the bottom line is that for a finite amount of time near the starting point, there will be no arrow of time. Things will just happen randomly. If you calculate the entropy, it will increase in some places, decrease in other places, in a pattern that doesn't have any particular direction to it. But in the far future, there will be a well-defined arrow of time where entropy gets larger as we go up on this timeline. And if we look to the negative times, there will also be a well-defined arrow of time, but it will be in the reverse direction. Entropy will grow to the past. Now, if you think about it, if you were living here, you would not notice that time is going backwards. It's really only going backwards relative to the way that time is going there. If you were living in this negative time region, you would simply say that the future was the values of time that are below in this diagram. And otherwise, everything would seem completely normal. You would just naturally choose the opposite definition of what's positive time and what's negative time. But everything would be completely consistent. So if you were living in this system, if you were living anywhere in the future, you would think there's a well-defined arrow of time going that way, and there's an infinite region up here if time continues forever. And if you're living in the past, you would be perfectly happy that you see an arrow of time. The arrow of time would go this way in our diagram, but to you it would look completely normal. And only for a finite region of time in the middle, which therefore, if you're choosing time randomly, would have zero probability, really. For a finite amount of time in the middle, there'd be a region where the arrow of time would not be well-defined. And finally, and I really am at the end now, I'd just like to emphasize that the ever-expanding gas that we've been talking about, we like to think of as a metaphor for the eternal inflation process that I talked about in each of the last two lectures, actually. So notice that there are similarities between those two situations. Here, we, in our toy model, we just have a gas that's expanding to fill an ever and ever larger region of space. And in eternal inflation, you have more and more bubble universes, pocket universes, forming. Creating a larger and larger region of space that's filled by these universes, which, with the whole system exponentially expanding. We don't yet really have a fully detailed version of how eternal inflation fits into the mold of this toy model. What we don't understand very well is the middle region. That is, we're not really sure how a universe that's going to become an eternally inflating universe should be behaving in this intermediate region. So we don't yet have a fully realistic version of this picture. But what I think our toy model shows clearly is that Don Page's statement is wrong, and that it is in principle possible, and I think even likely, that an hour of time can be generated from a system which has no hour of time in the initial conditions that you've made up, and has no hour of time in the fundamental laws of physics. And the latter is something that we know is true for our world. And what I'm saying is that we don't need to assume any special time reversal non-invariant conditions in the creation of the universe. So to summarize what I said, I've tried to show that time-symmetric laws of evolution with time-symmetric initial conditions can nonetheless produce an arrow of time. A key requirement of this is that the system it has to be a system with an infinite maximum possible entropy. If the maximum possible entropy was not infinite, you would approach that equilibrium state, and then you would have no well-defined arrow of time anymore. Finally, the arrow of time that's generated this way is two-headed, pointing to the future in the future and to the past in the past. And that's what I want to tell you. Thank you.
So thanks again for your story of times, which might be a bit, again, much food for thoughts. And I wonder whether there are comments and questions.
Am I allowed to ask you a question concerning yesterday? Yes, okay. And let's say there's a universe which doesn't behave or doesn't develop as our universe, but is there a probability that the universe is still able to look similar as ours? So with similar, I mean it has the same laws of physics.
I'm sorry, I'm not sure I heard the question.
Okay,
could you just say it again?
Oh, sorry, okay.
Yeah, standing up might help.
Let's say a universe which didn't develop as our universe, so perhaps the inflation didn't happen, and let's say the part after the inflation, or not the inflation, is still happening. Is there a probability that you can calculate that this universe has still the same laws of physics as ours, or can't you do that?
Okay. So you're asking about if there was another, we imagine another pocket universe, what's the probability that it has the same laws of physics that we have? Is that the question? Okay. The answer is that when we talk about the multiverse, we are assuming from the beginning that the ultimate laws of physics, the fundamental laws of physics, are the same everywhere. If we didn't assume that, we would really have no place to go. We would have no way of theorizing how life in other pocket universes would be. But the catch is that the physics that we see around us is not directly a consequence of the fundamental laws of physics alone. What we believe is that the vacuum that we're living in actually has a lot of structure in it, structure that's based on fields that are too hard for us to measure, to really be able to see directly what that structure is. But nonetheless, that structure of the vacuum has a huge effect on the effective laws of physics that we see. because everything that we see is really just a small fluctuation about the vacuum that we're living in. So string theory, which may or may not be the right theory that actually describes everything, predicts that there should be a huge number of different kinds of vacuum, different kinds of empty space, each having their own structure of fields defined in complicated ways. And each of these would have their own apparent laws of physics, and there would be as many as 10 to the 500 of them. So there could be many, many different kinds of physics that happen in the different pocket universes. And if there's 10 to the 500 choices, roughly speaking, the probability that any one of them would have the same as ours would be 10 to the minus 500. But that's only a very rough guess, really, because it may very well be that some of these are much more likely than others. And that's a question that at the present time we really know nothing about.
Okay. So, sorry, good evening. I have a little. Okay, maybe it's philosophical, maybe not. So
it's okay to be philosophical.
Okay. No, I mean, maybe it's really a matter of definition of words. But isn't your argument that when you have infinite entropy, allowed entropy, isn't it rather that, isn't it completely compatible with what Pope says, in the sense that, Page says, in the sense that what you're saying is that essentially any possible normalizable initial state has automatically inbuilt the asymmetry in time, in the sense that it cannot have, since you say, you argue that it cannot have infinite entropy to start with, so in already what you're really saying is that the asymmetry is in the starting conditions, only saying that in this particular case there are no reasonable states that don't contain this asymmetry.
Okay. Yeah, I would argue that that's not what we're saying. The state that we constructed was explicitly time reversal invariant statistically. And in fact, I didn't point out, but you raised the issue, so I should definitely point it out now. The entire picture of the world that we produce in this system is in fact exactly time reversal invariant. If you take this picture and turn it upside down, the labelings would look upside down, but otherwise the picture would look identical. And I think that really is important. In the end, the space-time that we create this way is completely time reversal invariant. It's just that locally there's a well-defined arrow of time. But the global picture is exactly the same as if you reverse time. So I think it's a very different answer than what Page had in mind.
Thank you. Okay. In so Feynman's answer to the hypothesis that our state is just a little fluctuation from the equilibrium says that we would see, as you said, gas equilibrium around us instead of other galaxies, if I understand you correctly.
Right.
How would we recognize this equilibrium gas?
How would we recognize it?
Obvious that it's equilibrium gas.
Well, it would be obvious that you don't see any galaxies other than our own. And we do see other galaxies, and astronomers can look at them carefully enough to see that they really look like our galaxy. And those galaxies should not be there if we were just a fluctuation from equilibrium.
So we
probably
there
being
nothing.
A second galaxy for us to look at, you know, even just one more, let alone 10 to the 11 more, is just infinitesimal.
Okay, thank you.
Anything? Very interesting lecture tonight. I wonder if Einstein had anything himself to say about this question, and what do you think he would have to say about your idea?
That's a very interesting question, and there are probably many people in the audience who know more about Einstein's thoughts about most subjects than I do, although I have read Einstein, but does anybody else want to answer the first part of that question? I'll take the responsibility for the second part. But does anybody know if Einstein ever wrote anything about the arrow of time? I don't know. As for what I think Einstein would think of this idea, I am absolutely convinced that Einstein would think it's completely brilliant.
The Indian people of Aymara, living in Bolivia, they have some interesting minds, I think. They say, and now please look to me, they say, past is in front of us, future is behind us. What do you think about?
Let's see, I'm not entirely sure I heard the beginning of what you said. I heard the past is in front of us, future is behind us. That statement came from someplace? Did you?
Take the microphone closer to your mouth. That would help.
Yeah.
They say, the interesting mind, they say, past is in front of us. We see. Future is behind us. You know, what do you think in a few words?
Okay. I think you are actually raising a very interesting question. Certainly one feature of the arrow of time is that we remember the past, but we don't remember the future. And somehow that's believed to arise from the growth of entropy. And it's not so obvious how that happens. And I think that's certainly a subject on which there's probably going to be more to be said in the future. I'm not sure people fully understand that. But what the idea that has been presented, which I think makes a certain amount of sense, but I think it needs to be developed further, at least I need to see a more detailed development of it than I've seen. But the basic idea is that in a world in which entropy is growing, when something happens, its influence spreads. Because things are, it's like the gas in the corner filling the box. Things that are localized in a world in which entropy is growing tend to move to other places. So when an event happens, to the future of that event, information about that event scatters over a large region. While if you follow the equations backwards and ask how does that event correlate with things that happened before it, they tend to be very local and not have this spread. And that is viewed as the reason why we can remember the past and not the future, based on the idea that entropy is growing, and that's the only distinction between the past and the future. So my guess is that idea is basically right, but I'll admit that I don't see enough flesh on the idea to be able to claim that I fully understand it.
In your toy model, you need a random number generator, which doesn't seem to be a time-reversible device for me. So does this play a role in the arrow of time?
Okay. So in case you didn't hear it, the question was, in my toy model, we made use of a random number generator. And the random number generator may not by itself be a time-reversible thing. Doesn't even sound like a time-reversible thing. So have I secretly somehow put in some time non-reversible information into my initial conditions? I don't think so, although we could talk about this further. I think the random number generator only influences the result by determining a probability distribution for the initial conditions. And that probability distribution for the initial conditions is explicitly time-reversal invariant. So I think even though the mechanism that one might use physically to create it is not time-reversal invariant, I think as long as you're convinced that what it's doing is creating something that is time-reversal invariant, I think that's enough.
Does it nothing have to do with our consciousness that time seems to be going in a direction, or is like physics sure about that this is a fact not depending on our consciousness, how it orders the things?
Okay, very interesting question. The question, in case you didn't hear it, was does consciousness play a role here? Is it possible that the arrow of time that we see is really entirely a product of our consciousness and not really something that should be thought of as being physical? And I guess that's a debatable question. Everything that we know comes through our consciousness, so it's hard to know what might be objective reality. But as far as the usual standards of what we mean by objective reality, which means things that we can actually measure with instruments, although in the end we interpret the readings of those instruments through our minds, but we tend to, in science, to assume that our instruments make sense and that there is a world of science determined by the outcome of experiments as registered on instruments. And in that sense, the growth of entropy is very real. And similarly, I think the arrow of time is real. Even a question as subtle as why we remember the future, well, yeah, I'll get this right. Why we remember the past and not the future, I've heard some people discuss it in terms of consciousness. But I think it's also true that physical things also remember the past and not the future. If a meteor hits a planet, it produces a crater, and the planet shows signs of craters of meteors that have hit it in the past, but not the future. So I think even a memory device as simple as a planet recording impacts of meteors have the same phenomena of remembering the past and not the future. So my feeling is that there is a very real physical distinction between past and future, but it does not come clearly from the fundamental laws of nature, at least as far as we know, because as far as we know, those are exactly time reversal invariant.
Okay. If we imagined we didn't have the accelerated expansion of the universe and the universe would at one point in time turn around, would that also turn around the arrow of time?
Okay, very interesting question. I don't know if you could all hear it, but the question was, suppose we didn't have an accelerating expansion, expanding universe, but instead a closed universe that would reach a maximum size and then turn around and ultimately undergo a big crunch. Would the arrow of time reverse at the turnaround? That actually has been a controversial question in recent years in physics, although right now I think everybody agrees on the answer. The controversy actually centered around Stephen Hawking, who had at one point made the statement that if we did live in a closed universe that reached the maximum size and turned around, he said that the arrow of time would reverse. But nobody really saw a mechanism for why the arrow of time would reverse. This idea of a statistical second law of thermodynamics doesn't seem to even know whether the universe is expanding or contracting. It really is just the behavior of things like gases as they approach uniform states of equilibrium. So most of the community did not believe what Hawking suggested. And eventually Hawking retracted. I don't know if that could have even been the dollar bet that we saw in the picture. I'm not sure. But Hawking did eventually agree with everybody else that the arrow of time would not reverse if the universe reached the maximum size and turned around. So in any case, that's the consensus of physicists and seems true to me. But obviously, nobody's tried the experiment.
Where was the other question?
There's no microphone up there, but maybe if you just speak out loud, then it's good.
Time moves forward.
Time rules our lives.
Like rules our lives? I'm sorry, okay.
And when you think about time as much as you do, and in this high level, does this affect your everyday life?
Oh, okay. That's a fun question that I never thought about. Does thinking about time affect my life? I think probably not, but it does affect, I guess, sometimes the way I talk about things. Like, if I'm late for an event, I tell them that my time machine just wasn't working that night, things like that. But I don't think it affects my life, although you never really know what affects your life, right? So it might.
My question is at the more microscopic level, not involving the discussion about the universe that you have made. you started with this nice classical example of the egg falling and breaking. And if you show this video, everybody can tell you if the video runs forward or backwards in time. Now, if you look at a gas, say, that contains red and blue atoms, and you see these atoms colliding, changing direction, velocity, at that level, you cannot distinguish whether a movie that you shoot of that scenario runs forward or backwards in time. But now suppose that you zoom out of the scenario, and you see that initially what you're seeing is a small fraction of a container where the left side contains red atoms and the left on the other side blue atoms. So in the microscopic picture where you see, say, only 100 atoms, you cannot distinguish in which direction. There's no arrow of time, apparently. But as soon as you zoom out, an arrow of time appears. What is the standard, the canonical explanation of the arrow of time appearing depending on the scale or length scale?
I think what you're describing is very much consistent with this idea that the arrow of time is determined by the growth of entropy. If you just look at one or two particles, you can't really tell what the entropy is. The entropy has to do with the statistical distribution of many particles. So since the arrow of time is defined by statistics, I think one expects to see exactly what you described, that on a microscopic level, when you just see the collision of two atoms, one red and one blue in your example, that collision is completely time reversal invariant. All you're really seeing, if you look at one collision, is the fundamental laws of nature themselves, which are time reversal invariant. But if you look at a large enough sample so that you could see the statistical behavior, then you could see entropy rise and a well-defined arrow of time. So I think it all fits together. What is large enough? Okay. Now that's a good question, but it's a quantitative question, and I don't really know how to give a quantitative answer. But roughly speaking, it's a question of having enough atoms to be able to effectively measure the entropy, and how many is that? I think I really just don't know how to give a good answer to your question. Although I agree with you, it's a well-defined question that deserves a good answer. But at the moment, I don't think I can really give you one.
Here, actually, Einstein had something to say. Here. I'm sorry. Actually, Einstein had something to say in his paper on Brownian motion.
Okay, yeah, that's right.
He realized that even at the levels of microns, the laws of thermodynamics are no longer really fulfilled. And so that, you know, that tells you about it can really be quite small, and then the normal thing of thermodynamics no longer valid.
There's another question up there. And so I was wondering whether quantum mechanics have anything to do with arrow of time. If, for instance, there's an observer who observes a state, the state collapses to a certain state, and then this kind of determines some arrow of time. So do you think the arrow of time in the universe and quantum
Very interesting thought. Certainly in the Copenhagen interpretation of quantum mechanics, when an observer observes the outcome of some experiment, the wave function collapses. And that, from the very beginning of the description, does in fact violate time asymmetry or time symmetry. And I guess some people have pointed to it as a possible origin to the arrow of time. I guess I would say that, number one, I'm a fan of the many worlds interpretation, and the Schrodinger equation itself is completely time reversal invariant, like the other laws of physics that we know. So it's just this collapse of the wave function, which is kind of put in by hand in the Copenhagen interpretation, that seems to violate time symmetry. If I could see some mathematical formalism which could really attribute the growth of entropy to the collapse of the wave function. I would take that seriously, but I don't think I've ever seen anything like that. That is, it's certainly true that collapsing wave functions violate time symmetry, but I've never really seen that that could be used in a way to explain how entropy grows as a consequence of that, although maybe I'm just ignorant about that. But certainly when we calculate the behavior of the entropy of a gas as it mixes in these toy models of gases and boxes, the collapse of wave functions never enters. One could think of it completely classically and still see the behavior that constitutes what we call the second law of thermodynamics. So the bottom line here, I think, is that there's a possibility that what you're saying is dead on and correct, but I don't quite see how it would work. Yes, okay, okay. Okay, so you say that, so you say, never mind the Copenhagen interpretation with thinking of the collapse of something physical, there's at least decoherence, and indeed, for people like me who try to talk about wave functions that don't collapse, it is decoherence that plays that role. But I would say that the decoherence is all consistent with the Schrodinger equation, and the Schrodinger equation is, by construction, explicitly exactly time reversal invariant. So I think it leaves open the same questions that I was addressing. You have completely time reversal invariant laws of physics. So where does the arrow of time come from? That question, I think, needs an answer. And to me, it seems that what I gave is a very plausible answer, because I think most any physical system will behave the same as my toy model. That is, if you start it with any entropy, entropy will tend to approach its maximum value, which means it will grow. And that's all I needed to assume. So I think if you don't have collapsing wave functions, then I don't think that quantum mechanics makes any big change in what I talked about, since the Schrodinger equation is time reversal invariant.
I have to admit frankly that I'm not, it's me over here.
Where?
Over here.
Okay. Thanks.
I frankly admit not to being a member of the scientific community, but I take chances as an ordinary citizen to go to attend lectures that are open to the public just to find out where my tax francs go to.
Okay. Very fair.
But I do read the leading Swiss newspaper nsz.ch on a regular basis, which publishes news about science on a weekly basis. You may have been interviewed during your stay here in Bern by its staff. And this newspaper published an article by Greg Easterbrook on the 23rd of October 1999, so that's 16 years ago. And the title of this article is Wissenschaftlicher Wunderglaube. If you translate this into English, it means Science, not Alice, Science in Wonderland. And this Mr. Easterbrook says, well, we believe in this Big Bang theory because the cathedral it comes from is called MIT. And the speaker is Professor Alan Guth. And so I checked tonight's your slides tonight, and I found out that on at least on three slides, you had to use the term, we assume. Now, the more assumption you make to form your model, the more likely the probability of an event becomes zero. So why should I believe that this theory works, since we can never, ever test it? That's my question number one. Question number two, which is last but three, my lifetime experience tells me that explosions are always destructive. So why should I believe that the first explosion that ever took place should have had and still have positive consequences? My question, second is, what, inverted commas, force, inverted commas, rotates our planet that smoothly that we don't make any note of the rotation. And now really, I come to my final question.
How are about taking notes?
We are limited to up.
Yeah, why don't we do the first ones? So let's see. The first, I think, was given this article by Easterbrook, which I think I even remember seeing. It was not only published here, but published in other places as well. Why should we believe these theories? And you particularly commented on the fact that several of my slides use the words "we assume." I think it's a question of really just understanding how science works. I think the way I would describe how science works is that theorists like me, and there's a lot of us, not just me, invent theories. And theories are all stated as assumptions. But then those theories are tested by whether or not those theories make predictions that agree with what observers see. And in particular, the inflationary theory makes a prediction for the mass density, which is now tested to 0.5% accuracy and agrees. And it makes a prediction for the patterns that we see in the ripples of the cosmic background radiation. And in each of the last two lectures, I showed you my favorite graph in the whole world, the graph of those results from the Planck satellite experiment, showing the intensity of the fluctuations as a function of the wavelength. And the curve goes like this and this, and agrees perfectly with what's predicted. So that's why I believe that there's sense to this. And you could choose for yourself whether to believe it or not. But there certainly is very distinct evidence that this theory is, if not exactly correct, is at least on very much on the right track. Now, I have to try to remember your second question.
Why was this first explosion not
destructive? Okay. Now, that's a good question. And that, by the way, really phrased with a slightly different emphasis is one way of describing the motivation for inflation in the first place. That is, what inflation replaced was some vague idea that the Big Bang was some explosion. And the point that you raise is very real, that typical explosions don't look nearly as uniform and smooth. You don't use those words, but I am. Typical explosions don't look nearly as uniform and smooth as apparently the Big Bang was. The early universe, shortly after the Big Bang, was uniform in its mass density to an accuracy of 1 part in 100,000. There's not really any way to arrange a conventional explosion that will do that, no known way. So inflation is not a conventional explosion. You may or may not decide to call it an explosion, depending on your use of vocabulary. But inflation, driven by this gravitational repulsion, has a very different property. The gravitational repulsion really does produce a state which is uniform in its mass density to incredible accuracy. And that's because the original distribution of particles just gets washed out by the enormous expansion. So the energy that you have left at the end of inflation is almost entirely energy that was created during the inflation. And that energy is created in the uniform distribution, subject only to these quantum fluctuations, which produce the ripples, which are now being, that pattern of ripples is now even being tested. So I think inflation really is very much the natural answer to the question of what would you invent if you were trying to invent something to explain how the universe started.
You talked a lot about the expanding universe, but what do you think is outside the universes or the universe? One can assume a big room like Newton did, and a space which is unlimited but defined. But I think Einstein said there's not such a room like Newton said. So what do you think is outside the universes? Outside the expanding or exploding universes.
Okay. I guess I would say that the structure of the multiverse, as I would view it as most likely being, is certainly a very complicated structure where there are pocket universes inside of pocket universes in a very complicated way, which is hard to visualize and hard to even know how to do calculations about. But I don't think there's any reason to believe that there's anything outside of that. Now, you might wonder, how could there be anything with nothing outside it? And that, I guess, is a question of how one thinks about the geometry of space. And people who have attempted to study general relativity think about the geometry of space rather differently from people who have not. So in the Euclidean context, forget general relativity for now. In the Euclidean context, space just goes on forever. And if the matter of the universe doesn't go on forever, then there must be some boundary beyond which there's something. And I think that's probably the kind of picture that you have in mind when you ask your question. Even if space is infinite, for all we know, there could be infinite amount of matter that fills it. That's actually quite possible as far as we know about the laws of physics. There's nothing that prevents that we know of. And an alternative to that, which is also possible in the context of general relativity, is that three-dimensional space can curve in such a way that the total volume is finite, even though there is no boundary. Now, that's very obvious in two dimensions. The surface of a sphere is a two-dimensional surface, which has no boundary, but it has a finite area. And there really is a three-dimensional analog of that, which was in fact, exactly Einstein's original model of the universe was the three-dimensional analog of the surface of a sphere. So it would be finite in size, but still have nothing outside it, no boundaries. The sphere would be everything that exists. So there are lots of possibilities, but I don't think there's any need to believe that there's something outside the universe.
Okay, so thank you. We close now the question session, but before we go away, I'll give the word to Jens Uwe.
Yeah, so before I thank Alan for three wonderful lectures, and before I thank you for coming here to listen to all this, I would like not to forget that there were a lot of people behind the scenes helping that all this work smoothly. So first of all, there were people making sure that the logistics in this room worked, that the beamers were working, the microphones are working, and so there's Daniel Tröler from the Hausdienst who helped tremendously. Then Terkel Olesen made sure that everything went great. He was helped by Stefan Kaspar and Manuel Meyer. Then the lectures were podcasted, and the podcast will be available through the university's website. The people who did that are Kuno Sorgen and Patrick Pellegrini. Then we had great help from the communication department of our university. I particularly want to mention Tim Eugster, but also other people helped to publicize the events. David Mesterhasi organized a press conference, and Annette Boutelier was involved, Martin Zimmermann as well. Then there were people making sure that the information was spread properly. There were Mala Eva Moser, Nadia Vlasi, Wynn Evans, and Markus Krebs, and also our secretary, Esther Fichter. And last but not least, I would like my fellow committee members, now in the seventh year of these Einstein lectures, Professor Tretter and Professor Ott, thanks to all these people, because otherwise this event would not have been possible. And so I think we can give a big hand to those helpers. And then I can only say thank you so much, Alan, for three wonderful lectures. We have all learned a lot, and it was really exciting to listen to your explanation. So I'm so glad that you came and everything went super perfect from my point of view. Now, you were so busy preparing everything, making sure that all explanations were so clear that you had hardly any time to experience Bern. And so as you go back, you can see what you have all missed.
Okay, should I open it now or why not?
Okay, so this brings us to the end of this year's three lectures, and I would like to remind you we are already working on next year's events, and I hope you will show the same interest in about a year from now. And so I can only wish you good night and happy Christmas.